protecting critical infrastructure in cyberspace.
So good morning, everyone. Thanks for coming. My name is Salo. Together with Thomas and Jorge, I also work for OICT. I'm part of a small team that specializes in cybersecurity. And today we'll talk a bit about industrial and critical infrastructure. This is not going to be a technical presentation, but I'm gonna show a couple of examples that hopefully help you guys visualize a bit better what those systems are, where are they present in our everyday life, and how they may affect us if they get compromised. So this is briefly the items I'm going to be talking about. The first one is going to be a basic introduction to industrial control systems, what they are, what they control, what they use for, all those things. And then I'll mention a bit some of the operational considerations that go with these systems. Why are they special in their own way, and why certain things cannot be done in the same way that some of the things that Thomas was mentioning to protect infrastructure. Then we'll move on to a more practical thing. I intend to show this live on the demo. I call it here internet footprint. What I mean by that is if an attacker was to try and find those things and compromise them, how would he do that, right? And I will show a tool that is widely used for both good and bad purposes. And it helps you very easily locate some of those things that also Thomas was mentioning. Then I'll move on to a couple of examples that I hope are going to be relevant. One of them, it has to do with the power grid and solar components. The other one is a diesel generator, the kind you have in places where power supply is not very stable. Typically, there's a generator. So we'll see what can happen if one was to attack one of those things. And finally, I'll tie it up together with a Security Council resolution on industrial and critical infrastructure that came up a year ago in February. And finally, we'll have some time for some questions. So the first thing is industrial control system, right? There's three parts to this. The first thing is the industrial, which is easy. Industrial processes, right? We'll have some examples in mind. It's basically a process or a combination of processes that tries to achieve some objective, be it manufacturing, be it chemical producers, pharmaceutical, think of any industry you want, right? Those industrial processes are typically controlled by machines that sort of make sure everything stays within range and things get done as they should, right? So the systems that help you control those processes physically is what we call industrial control systems, right? There's plenty of examples, I'll get to one of them in a second. But that's a very generic term to say any computer-based intelligence that goes with those physical processes. And finally, critical infrastructure is a subset of industrial systems. And it's basically a term used to describe any asset that is essential to the good functioning, proper functioning of a country. Think public health, think water supply, think power grid, etc. So those are the three things we're going to be looking into. Since we're in New York, I picked this example. I think it's a good one. So on the bottom side, this thing here, this is a boiler. Most of the New York buildings have one, especially if you live in a pre-war building. That's how they heat those apartments. They're typically located in the basement. And what they do is they're filled with water, right? And then the boiler, it will use either electricity or some sort of fuel to heat up that water, right? When the water is hot enough, depending on the generator, either the water itself or some steam, it will be sent through the pipes all the way up the building. And then on each floor, the pipes divert, and they all feed into your radiators, right? So in those buildings, when they turn up the heating, what they do is they start this machine, the water gets heated up, the steam goes up, and then it goes to your radiators, right? So on the top part, you have these three items here, sensors, controller, and actuators. Any industrial system, no matter how complex, can be modeled with those components, right? They typically get a little more complex, but this explains well the idea. So in this part here, the sensors, what are they? those are inputs for my process, right? So in this case, in the boiler, I'm gonna have probably a sensor that tells me what, how hot the water is, how much fuel I have left, what's the pressure in the tank, all of those things that help me control what's happening, right? The controller here, think of it as a very, very basic computer that only does one thing, but does it really well. And it only does that, right? So the controller will take the input from the sensors every second or every half a second, whatever it is. And based on those inputs, it will decide what to do, right? Again, in the boiler example, say the sensor is telling you temperature of the water is 20 degrees, right? So the controller will say, okay, this is not enough. I'm gonna tell an actuator, which is actually a physical device doing something, I'll tell him to continue heating the water, right? Then the sensor will measure again, and it will say, okay, now it's 25. So the controller will say, okay, it's not hot enough, so please keep doing this, right? And there's a circle that goes on automatically, and eventually the sensor will say, okay, the water is hot enough. So now the controller will say, okay, stop heating, and then open the valve so the steam can go up the pipes, right? And it will, then it will continue releasing the steam until it gets cold again, and then it will go back to reheating. So that's the main idea of those three components. This happens sort of transparently to humans because those are machines talking to each other. However, for humans to understand what's happening and be able to intervene if something goes wrong, there's the so-called management system, right? I put an example here. It's a graphical interface that people can look at and quickly see if there's any problem, right? So you cannot see very well, but you have some gauges and some indicators. You see things are in the green. This, for instance, tells you the steam flow rate, meaning enough steam is going up so you can be sure it's being heated up properly. This tells you how much fuel you have left. This thing will tell you how much water you have left in the deposit. So all of those things to help you control what's happening, right? If an operator sees that there's something wrong, he will look at this panel here and then he can interact. He can switch on the machine if there's an issue. He can turn on and off the valves if he wants to override some of the controller settings. So that's how a person would make sure this is happening, right? This is a very simple example for a boiler in a building. Of course, you can think, for instance, in a power plant where you may have thousands of components, actually, this gets a lot more complex. And that's why it's not so trivial for a human to know what's happening at any time. If we have time later, I'll show a slide for a real world case example so you'll see how complex it gets. So this would be an industrial process. Those systems, industrial control systems, they've been around for a long time. And historically, they all had certain things in common, right? These four here are some of the most important ones. Historically, they have been isolated, meaning you would have a system that was enclosed on its own and there was no way to interact with it except for physically accessing it, right? They use some proprietary hardware and software. We're not gonna get into that now. They're typically located in physically secure areas. In the case of the boiler, for instance, it's not so difficult to go down to the basement if you have a key, probably. But if you think of a power plant again, you are gonna have a fence, you're gonna have cameras, you're gonna have probably some security guards. So it's not so easy for me to go in there and plug my computer to one of those things, right? So that's a level of security that historically has been there. And the last thing is the key point here. Historically, those things, they were never connected to IT networks or the internet for that matter, right? So what would happen is if say you're an operator and there's a blackout in some power plant, you typically would have to ship an operator to the middle of nowhere so he would actually have a look at the machine and fix it, right? There was no way for you to remotely access the machine. That is changing now, however, right? We're having, as Thomas was mentioning, IT is more and more part of our day-to-day lives. And industrial systems are not an exception. So more and more this kind of infrastructure relies on IT system for, you know, to be able to help control the operational side. Also the networks are getting interconnected, right? So what you used to have before as a closed network, now is suddenly accessible from the internet, right? I'm not saying that's good or bad. I'm saying if it's done, it has to be done properly, right? Because if it's not, you're opening the door to a lot of attacks. An example, Thomas mentioned the WannaCry case. That's ransomware that's typically targeted to normal people like us. You know, it's gonna log your data and you may be inclined to pay. However, because of a poor deployment, it also ended up hitting critical infrastructure in the case of WannaCry, the UK's national health system was affected because unintentionally they had some of those systems exposed to the internet and they were hit by it, right? So this shows how those things start getting more and more interconnected. And again, in line with what Thomas was saying, there's some targeted attacks, right? If someone wants to conduct an attack against a specific power plant or against a specific industrial facility, nowadays it's easier to do that because you may not have to be physically there, right? So all in all, what's happening is that society and regulators and pretty much everyone has realized that cybersecurity in the industrial world has to be addressed and properly managed, right? The good news is 90% of the things you have to do to keep these things secure are the same things that you would do in your normal enterprise IT, the things Thomas was mentioning, right? The bad news is that because of some of the very unique operational conditions that these things operate on, and I'll get into that in a sec, you cannot always do that. So things like patching a computer are not so trivial. You may or may not be able to do that, and I'll mention why in a bit. So what are those differences? The first one is a long lifespan, right? I think we've all been there when you buy an iPhone or a computer, and in 2 years, it's, you know, the battery doesn't work, or it's too slow, and you're forced to replace it, right? Because they designed those devices, so in 2-3 years, you have to get a new one, right? In the ICS world, typically those things are designed to last for a much longer period of time, anything between 15 and up to 30 years, right? Because sometimes you're gonna take those things and you're gonna deploy them in some remote facility where you don't want to have to deal with that anymore. They're designed to withstand for a long time, and they only do one thing, but they do it very well, right? What happens with that is that some of those things have been around for a long time, and a few years ago, security wasn't an issue, or not a big issue as it is now. So when they designed those things, they never thought security would be a problem, so they didn't put any security controls in them. And then that makes them very vulnerable to attacks. And we'll see a couple of examples later. Along with this, because you have a long lifespan, you also have a lot of unsupported systems. What this means is, think of your Windows, right? A few years ago, you probably all had Windows XP, right? So what Microsoft does is, they support a certain operating system for a while. They issue patches and maintenance and alerts and all that. But at some point they say, okay, you know what? I'm not gonna be maintaining this anymore. So you have 1 year to move to something newer and better, right? You're free to do so. If you do not, however, you're on your own. So if there's any new attack vector that they find for that out of support system, Microsoft is not going to help you. You're on your own, right? So what happens in those facilities is that they have deployed some very old systems that no one is responsible for them anymore, right? So the obvious question is, why don't they just replace them, right, and put something newer? And that brings me to my next 2 points. Those systems, they typically control physical processes, and they have very strict availability requirements, right? Be it economical or be it from a safety point of view. For instance, in any factory, in any production factory, they typically have some targets, right? Every day they have to produce 5,000 units or 3,000 or whatever it is. So if you go to one of the plant engineers and tell him, hey, we need to stop this production line for 3 hours, I need to update something, he's gonna tell you, no, I don't think that's happening, right? So that's something that cannot be easily done. And that's why, and we'll get to that later again, when you talk security in those environments, it has to be a cross-domain approach. You need to have security people, but you also need engineers and local plants and so on, right? Finally, those things, they also have response time requirements, right? Think of it, for instance, in pharmaceutical industry. Sometimes when you mix compounds and when you are preparing your drug batches, the requirements are very strict in terms of, some of them are even measured in parts per million, right? So if that thing doesn't work exactly as it's intended to, a delay of 1 second in pouring a batch into a mix may be catastrophic, right? So because of that, those environments, once they are working fine, the trend is don't touch them, let it be, right? And finally, to make it a bit worse, there's no such thing as test environment, right? In your IT enterprise infrastructure, right? When Thomas, for instance, he does some migration or he wants to update systems for everyone in the secretariat so it's more secure, what he does is he first applies the change in a control environment, right? So if something goes wrong, you guys will not feel it, right? Only when he's certain that that's fit for production and there's no side effects, then the changes roll out, right? Unfortunately, in the industrial world, you cannot do that, because most of the times it would be just cost prohibitive to have a replica of your power plant to do this kind of testing, right? So when you do these updates and when you want to modify things in a real production environment, you only have one shot to do it right. And to make it worse, if something goes wrong, then some physical processes may be affected, right? So when you do those things, there has to be a lot of careful planning, there has to be some mitigation measures in case something goes wrong, and it requires a lot of thorough thinking, right? So that's for the basic theory, right? We saw what those systems are and what makes them a bit more special in terms of security, why you cannot just use your traditional approaches, right? So now we get onto the next part. Thomas was mentioning a couple of attacks. Mirai was a botnet where they compromised a lot of webcams. So how do attackers find those things, right? How easy it is for them to go and say, okay, there's a webcam in Barcelona that I'm gonna hack, or there's one in, I don't know, Greenland, whatever it is. So the answer is there are a couple of ways to do that, but by far the most popular one is using something called Shodan. I'll show it in a minute live, but most of you may be aware with it. So when you want to search information on a certain website, right, you go to Google and you type your query, and then Google will tell you those websites are relevant to your search, and that's how you browse, right? So Shodan is the same idea. But instead of looking for information or instead of looking for websites, you can look for devices. So you can run a query saying, show me all the webcams that are publicly accessible in a certain country. Or you can say, show me all the printers that the UN has exposed to the internet. Hopefully the answer to that is no. But you can run these kind of queries, right? And of course, you can find your classical IT infrastructure, servers, databases, but the interesting thing is you can also find IoT devices, meaning webcams, baby monitors, toasters, anything that is connected to the internet and shouldn't be connected to the internet directly can be found. And if this thing can find it, it means attackers can find it, it means it can be attacked, right? So what this does is if you don't do these things properly, you're increasing your risk exposure, right? I'll mention a bit later how you can do these things in a secure way. So these are two screenshots before I move to the actual browser. The one you see on the bottom left, this thing here, is just an example. I'm not showing the IPs or anything. You remember in the boiler example where I showed there was a control screen for the operator to say turn on the valve, switch off the valve. The technical term for that is an HMI, is a human machine interface. So this thing here is an HMI panel for some industrial device, right? As you can see, it's protected by a user and a password, so it's not so easy to access. However, there may be ways to bypass that. I will not get into this presentation. But that's already making the attacker's life a lot easier because they can find those things, which is the first step, right? And the one behind is Shodan, the thing I'm gonna show. This is an animation that they created for industrial control systems that are directly accessible from the internet. So when you see red points, it means that the density is higher. Obviously, the US has many of them. South America has a bit less. I'll show now, actually. So this is Shodan, right? It's free of use. Anyone can go there. Anyone can use it. You can go to shodan.io. This is used, again, by security researchers, right? So it's a bit of a cat and mouse game, as Thomas was mentioning. Say I'm one of the good guys, if I see that someone has done something improperly, I may choose to tell him, hey, I found this on Shodan, you may want to make sure this is taken care of, right? Or if I'm a bad guy, I'm going to say, oh, cool, I found this thing, let me hack into it, right? So there's two sides to this thing. So for instance, say I want to see everything that the UN has posted publicly on the internet, right? You have some details on how to use it. The way I would run that search I was mentioning is if I say show me for the organization United Nations, right, it's going to show me a bunch of things here. It's going to take a while to load. But it's low. Now, when you look at those results, you have to take it with a pinch of salt, right? Not everything that is here should not be here, but chances are some of the things, not in the UN case in general, some of the things that you find here, most likely they wouldn't be here. For instance, things that will appear here and they should be there is your webmail. Why? Because when you want to access your mail, webmail, you want to be able to access from anywhere. So that has to be exposed, right? Something that shouldn't be here, for instance, is your office printer, right? If you can access your office printer from the internet, then you have a problem, security problem, right? So in this case, Sean shows you a bunch of things, a bunch of technical details. In this case, no surprise, it tells you the countries with most devices. In the UN case, no surprise, there's the US for New York, Geneva, Brindisi and Rome for WFP and all those guys, Nairobi in Kenya, and then Austria where you have most of the atomic agencies and all those guys, right? So there's no surprise. If you were to click into one of those things, which in this case, so anyway, if you click onto this, it will give you more details, right? So it will tell you basically how you can talk to those devices at the machine level, right? So it will tell you, if you connect to this machine doing certain things, you can talk, right? So that's for your IT thing, right? It can be used for many other things. So the thing that brought us here is industrial systems. So they already had a couple of categories, right? So I'm not gonna get into details, there's a bunch of them. I'm gonna mention these two, mostly, and this maybe. So DMP is a protocol that is mostly used in power grids and power plant and water plants. This one here, Ethernet over IP, is a protocol that is used, you remember in the boiler case, I was showing you the controller that takes the input from the sensors and does things. So the way the sensors and the controller talk is by using this thing, right? And BACnet, finally, that's used for air conditioning, heating, and even some of the fire systems, right? So if we click on, say, this one, right? So it's giving me some of the results. It tells me countries where they are. So this is how an attacker would say, you know what, I want to find some of those systems. So the fact that they are found, it means that I could sit anywhere in the world and access them, right? Doesn't mean that all of them shouldn't be there, but chances are some of them should not be there, right? So the bottom line in this is, if you have to expose something to the internet, my piece of advice is A, do that only if you really have to, and B, if you do, follow some of the security standards that will help you be more secure. The two-factor thing Thomas was mentioning and a couple of other mitigations you can use. If we go, for instance, to say Ethernet IP, I expect to see here some of those controllers. This is typically not a good idea because if you can talk to a controller, right? Imagine the boiler case. If I can talk to the controller and somehow I can compromise it, I can say things like, you know what, whatever is coming from the sensor, ignore it. Just keep on heating, right? So if the boiler doesn't have embedded something that would prevent it from overheating or even increasing the pressure too much, there may be some physical consequence to it, right? So chances are most of the things that you see here should not be here, right? Because those are, yeah, you see, I don't know if you can see. So these are PLC, that's the controller I was showing you. Those things should not be accessible from the internet for the most part, right? So that's bad. And the last example is, for instance, this one. That's for air conditioning and heating. Some vendors need to have remote access. So typically when you, as a company, when you buy one of those systems, right, the vendor will do the operation, the maintenance for you. So they need some sort of access, right? That access can be done in a proper, secure way, or it can be done in a less secure way, right? So again, in some of those cases, chances are the access is not as controlled as it should, right? Meaning someone may connect to one of those devices, and if there's any way to exploit them or if there's any vulnerability, you may be able to affect, for instance, the air conditioning or the heating one of those facilities, right? So there's some examples. That's basically how attackers can automate the process of finding those things. And show them what we saw now is a snapshot as of now, right? If I was to change the configuration of the UN and expose something else new, it will be here within minutes. So this is a bit like Google, it keeps on crawling, and as soon as there's something new, it appears here. So it has a very up-to-date picture of the risk of exposure, right? Most security companies, as part of their operational tasks, they monitor this, right? So if there's anything from your organization that is showing up there that it shouldn't, you want to have a look at it before someone else does, right? So that's for Sheldon. And then finally, I'm gonna go through two attack scenarios. I'm gonna mention the first one. Let me give you a bit of context first. It has to do with the electrical grid and with one European country, right? It's a European country that has a lot of solar capacity installed at the household level. So say you build a house or you buy an apartment there. By law, you're even encouraged, I think you have some discounts. You can install your own solar power generator. So there are two ways you use it, right? When you're at home and you're consuming electricity, you may draw electricity from your own solar installation, so you pay less in terms of electricity. Or if you're not home, you can take that power and feed it back into the grid. So the utility will pay you some money because you're giving them electricity, right? And then they will sell the electricity. The thing about the power grid is fairly complex. There's a lot of interdependencies. And there's a couple of funny stories. For instance, in the US, I didn't know until recently, in the US you have the East, for the East Coast, for the grid, right? You have the West, and then you have Texas. Texas has its own power grid, which is something that amazes me. In Europe, most of those countries are interconnected, right? So if say there's a shortage of power in the Netherlands, right? Germany may decide to sell power to them, and they're interconnected. So this happens every day, there's a spot market, they trade, it's fairly complex. But the bottom line is that the power grid has to be balanced. What do I mean by balanced? Most of the time, or at all times, supply has to more or less equal demand, right? So if there's a lot of supply, it's because there's a lot of demand. Or if there's a lot of people trying to get electricity, there has to be enough supply. If there's an imbalance, then things start going wrong. And if there's no defensive measures, because everything is connected, it starts cascading, right? Probably you've heard every summer in California they have the same issue. July, August is super hot, everyone turns on the AC at the same time. The grid cannot cope with it, and boom, there's a blackout, right? So that's how the power grid more or less works. In this case, what happened is a security company did a study, and their premise is, okay, if I manage to hack into someone's house and I get control of the solar installation he has, right? If I modify the thing to start sending all of the power it creates to the network or drawing power, nothing's gonna happen, right? Because the fraction of power compared to the overall is not relevant, so nothing will happen. However, what happens if I manage to hack thousands of those devices at the same time, and at the same time I tell them, send all of the power to the grid or draw power to the grid? In that case, there's a potential for something to go out of balance and something may happen, right? So there's a security company that what they did is specifically the vulnerability has to do with this, that's a piece of the solar equipment. So they bought a bunch of those devices from a vendor and they tried to see if there was any security problems with them, right? So they found a lot of things. And they claim that based on those things, it's theoretically possible to actually compromise them remotely and at the same time orchestrate an attack, right? And they have a website, if you Google horror scenario, you can read all about it. So from the statement, it's a bit of a catastrophic sort of doomsday sort of thing, but it's basically saying if you're able to compromise many of them at the same time, you may be able to have an effect on the grid, right? There are two sides to this story. So the security company claims that's totally possible. Of course, the manufacturer that they picked for this, producing those solar inverters, they have their own version of the story. There's a white paper that you can also read by yourself. What they're saying is, it's true that we have some issues, but not all of them are as bad. And their key point here is, what they're saying is, for you to be able to exploit those devices, you have to hack into that person's home first, which is a fair point, right? But as we saw from Thomas and the webcams, right? Not everyone knows how to deploy those things securely. So it became a case of a bit of finger pointing, because the grid operator in that country said, whatever you plug into my network, it has to be secure. Then the vendor would say, well, it's secure, but if you deploy it securely. So my thing is okay, but you have to deploy it securely. And then the final user would say, I'm not an expert in these things, just give me something that works out of the box, right? So that's a good example of how the only way to achieve security in those things, in lines of what Thomas was saying before, is through collaboration and partnerships, right? The next example I want to show you is, let me first say it was carried out under control conditions, right? So in this case, what they did is they gave a bunch of researchers a diesel generator in a power plant, right? Those things are massive, I'm gonna show you now. So they asked them, is there anything you could do if you wanted to attack this thing, if you wanted to hack into it, could you actually cause it to malfunction or stop working or something? So those guys went at it, and there's a 1 minute video. It's from a few years ago, it's public, so again, I'm not disclosing anything that is secret here. So what you're gonna see here is, this is the diesel generator in a power plant. Again, it's a staged power plant, so it's not a real production one, right? You can see that the generator is shaking now and then. That's the guys trying to send commands to do something with the engine. So if the engine was spinning and you stop it suddenly, then it's going to do the shaking, right? And the second part of the attack they did is they started spinning the engines faster than they should, right? And then this happened. So it burned inside and then obviously it stopped working. Now, if that generator has some safe controls on top, it may be able to deal with this, right? I'm gonna call them hard-coded controls that say, you know, if this is spinning out of control, stop it. But if they don't have those things, then you may be able to cause some damage, right? Those are two examples. There are plenty if you Google or if you go to that site Thomas was mentioning. But because you have those things that are not meant to be secure by design, accessible from anywhere in the internet, it means there's potential for people to access and do those things, right? Now, this sector is getting a lot better in security. All of the security companies are also investing heavily in this. There's emergency response teams working specifically in this. So there's a lot of things being done, right? But all of this ties nicely, and with this I will finish, with the Security Council resolution that was issued a year ago now, in February 2017. You can Google it, it's 2341. I must mention this resolution, it comes from a purely counter-terrorism activities angle. So our colleagues from CTEV or OCT may be able to elaborate a bit more. But what the resolution does is it basically calls upon member states to take this into consideration in their national strategies and make sure those things are secured properly, right? There's a bunch of things mentioned in that resolution, but one of the key points in my opinion is the stress on coordinated efforts and awareness and exchange of information. The IT security world, it advanced a lot lately thanks to open and collaboration and sharing of intel, right? Because if, say, the UN gets hacked or if another entity gets hacked, if you get that information before the attacker tries it on you, you have a lot more chances to defend yourself as opposed to just not doing that. So same thing applies here. And they also make a couple of points on, of course, each state has to know, has to determine what is critical for them, for their operations. And the last thing they mention is, one thing is protecting against attacks, right? So to prevent them from happening. But in case they do happen, you need to know how to ensure that the operation keeps running, right? How to recover from the incident, eventually how to investigate it. So all those things they were mentioning about attribution and prosecution can be eventually done. Right. And with this, I think I'll finish. I'll open the floor for questions.
I have a comment. I am going to unplug all my security cameras. I am scared now.